Yeah. Hello, everyone. Okay. Should we start? Now, on monetization of apps, the way I put together the presentation and the session is there's a lot of research, and there are a lot of new models which got announced. There are a lot of new things which are happening across the world. I have given certain assertions in the middle, and some of these assertions have pun intended, so please take the right meaning out of it. I also thought this was a 45-minute presentation, so I got in a lot of data for all of you, but it seems like it's a 20-25-minute presentation. So we'll try to just push through phases where we feel we can. So this is an interesting infographic which practically can explain you how to monetize apps. All the directions are there. I found it pretty interesting. It's not that it's the final solution, but generically, if you are a gaming application or a content application or a utility, or what are different things you like to do? Now, the first thing, we know mobile is big, smartphones are big, and apps are big. Smartphones have already overtaken the PC sales. Now, this is 2015 expected data. Tablet sales will go beyond PC. Time spent on apps is already rising, pretty big. Mobile usage for Pandora and Twitter is beyond 50%, and that's expected out of a mobile music service for sure. Now, mobile internet adoption is also growing at a pretty solid pace. It's a slightly old graph, but the growth is pretty imminent, if you see. This is a relatively latest research. We see 50K plus rising in 2012 for smartphone users, so the potential buyers, quote unquote, the rich class who can afford things. Perception about mobile advertising is changing. It's pretty positive. The research given here is between content buyers and total smartphone users. Obviously, the content buyers are giving more positive remark. Now, the interesting part of this research and some of the research which I'm showing you is that I have seen data exactly opposite to the same by some other research. So there is a Business Insider research which I saw wherein it said that perception about mobile advertising by smartphone users is actually on slightly negative. So a lot of this data you have to take with a pinch of salt, but the usage on smartphone is pretty big. So another important metric is action taken after seeing the ad on mobile. There also we see a lot of action happening, especially the content buyers are taking twice as likely action after seeing the ad. This is as per the latest Gartner's research. This year expected 46 billion mobile app downloads are there, which is almost double of last year. Now, this is a very interesting metric. This year, the price of apps have come down. And 90% of apps which got launched, $2.99 or less, 150, 165 rupees or lesser. So this is a bit of a correction which has happened across markets. Apple app downloads have grown by 74%. And the overall market has grown by 83%. So Apple is slightly behind, assuming I'll come to some Apple versus Android data. Now, this year expected revenue from paid apps is supposed to be close to 20 billion. And that's not a metric which I've seen in a lot of other research, but this is one research which has quoted a metric. So this sounds like a big metric against a mobile app mobile advertising of around $6 billion. In OPA research, smartphone adoption is increasing. 93% of smartphone users access content and information on their smartphones regularly. 84% of smartphone owners use mobile phone or tablet, so that second screen concept is coming to life. 24% smartphone owners have purchased some sort of content online. Now, Android versus iOS important for mobile monetization because obviously iOS monetizes better. Android is winning in numbers and coming very close in monetization as well. There's the latest research which I read on by Loyalytics, wherein they showed how Google Play Store can give you a lot of impetus if you are an early success in the Play Store. Now, this is a global research, and Android now controls 46% of the market by type of smartphones owned. iOS still leads in revenues. If you see the last metric, $100 plus spends by smartphone owners, Apple is still the double of Android. So that is where monetization control still lies with iOS, but Google Play Store has really started to do well in recent past. A little bit of snapshot of India market. India market in 2012 is expected to be 18 million smartphones. And I know numbers are here and there, but more or less, May, we were close to 0.5 million shipments, wherein 70% is controlled by Samsung. So even in India, 18 to 20 million smartphones will be there for the year 2012. So the conclusion out of this is, everyone knows the audience is there and spending a lot of time in apps. I don't think there's any confusion on that. But it's like, you know, we heard for internet 8-10 years back, you know, a lot of buyers will say it's a new medium, it's new, you know, let's see how where it goes, and you know, there's not enough investment into it. So that it's new media is pun intended, and that's what I hear about mobile a lot of times. Now, these are very standard ways of app monetization, and almost everybody knows it, and that is why I think the ways and means of app monetization is pretty standard. But the approach towards app monetization is very, very different for different people. And I think the approach is actually the game changer. And I'll show you a lot of case studies how different people have approached differently. And the approach has to be according to the ecosystem or platform you're getting into. This is a very, very important assertion. So in the middle, I'm just throwing in some assertions. I think the casual users are going to go the freemium route and use apps to entertain themselves for short stints, which makes mobile advertising in-app purchase very, very important. So this is a very, very important assertion from my side. So these two things are going to be very important. Now, monetization strategies need to be conceived from very beginning. This is a bit of an important, non-important factor, because monetization has to be thought out right from the beginning. What do you want to do? How do you want to do it? And later on, design and other changes are very difficult to do. And we've seen some of those challenges in our own products. We built some great products from usability perspective, and later on, integrating advertisements into them was a little difficult. Now, this is generally, I mean, almost every case I've read, you know, there is this requirement of great game builders and content builders. You know, they ally with a mobile advertiser very early, and they get in the brand attributes in app logic and design. But, you know, here is a big assertion again, but the first priority has to be the best gaming usability or app experience which you want to build. So later on also, when we talk about this particular thing, it is very, very important to understand that the first priority always has to be the people should love your app, whether it's a game, it's a content app, it's a utility app. The most important part is you should first focus on audiences loving your app. So I'll share a Times Internet case study. Incidentally, Rishi is here. When we build the strategy. When we built the TOI and ET app, our key focus was product experience, design, and usability. And incidentally, I being the sales strategy head also, I was fighting with Rishi all the time that, you know, we need more spaces for advertisements and, you know, more ways of monetization. And he said, no, let's go with let's make a great product. And the second focus we did was that we will not start monetizing till we reach a certain number or we're going to go big in numbers and then we're going to start targeting. Third call we took was that, you know, we're going to go the premium publisher model. We're going to have a dedicated sales team whenever we monetize this, and we're not going to use ad networks. I know there was a huge discussion over this, and I think there's a great DSP ecosystem backing the supply side, and I'm going to talk about it a little later. But we took a, you know, call, which was a conscious call, that we are not going to go with networks and we're going to monetize on our own. And it kind of happened for around 8-9 months. We were not available. A lot of people chased us. And the first deal we took was a Volkswagen sponsorship. So these are some key results by the focus. Now today we have 11 million UVs on mobile and 4.5 million app downloads across platforms for Times of India. Probably the biggest content app downloaded on both Android and iOS universe in India. And ET also is doing pretty well with 1.5 million app downloads across platforms and 3 million UVs including the web platforms. So, I mean, I know the learning is not visible here, and it was a tough time arguing within the company what we need to do finally. But like I said earlier, we stuck to a norm that we're not going to compromise with product experience, and the app should viral and it should hit the top of App Store. And I think Times of India stayed in top 10 for more than 8-9 months, which was quite an achievement. And then we opened up the sponsorship gates. Today we have a dedicated team selling the app. So the monetization strategy took a lot of cost and effort behind it. But that was a conscious call. So it depends upon you, how you want to take this forward. And Times of India and ET are big brands. You know, they're well-established brands. Sometimes for new brands, you may not like to do this. But this is the way we approached it. We're going to launch Gaana music apps soon, but there our approach will be very different. Another thing I'd like to share as marketing head is that each time we went on mobile, we went very aggressive. So we went for a lot of downloads. That was our key strategy. And that was driven through brute force marketing early on. But I think the mobile on marketing on mobile has changed in last 1 year. And today, I think there are far more options than there were one and a half years before. When we were doing campaigns earlier, the scalability of campaigns was very tight. So we did banner ads, inline videos, and rich media as options, which could convert into sponsorship options. Here are some of the examples. Now, everybody says this, and I think this is correct. The mobile screen is really small. And again, a statement with pun intended. That means mobile is not working out for a lot of people. And I think there is some truth in that as well. There are challenges in mobile ad buying. It's fragmented market, it's tracking challenges. You know, people ask, where are my ads? I never see them. It was a similar question which people in the internet used to ask. Where is my ad? I am on the homepage. So I used to tell him, hey, look, you know, there's ad server. You refresh it 5-7 times, you may see it. He said, I've done it 10 times. I still am not able to see it. So there are those challenges. There's lack of insights, there's poor optimization. You know, when we track downloads, we see there is no mechanism to track downloads on a BlackBerry. I mean, on an iOS and Android, there can be a code fired which can tell you a cost per install kind of calculation. But on BlackBerry, I think it is impossible. I don't know if somebody's cracked it. You can let me know. Mobile CPMs are lower. It's a worldwide phenomenon. And mobile advertising still is a fraction of digital advertising. So, and then there has been a lot of talk of click frauds. As per some study, almost 40% clicks have challenges. Some are accidental and some are otherwise. So there are challenges on mobile advertising and mobile monetization. So I'll take some more case studies wherein these challenges have been surpassed. Here's another perception. Mobile advertising works for large publishers and the games which go wild. So we'll take, just have a look at the Pandora case study. Pandora is one of the leading music internet radio sites across the world. Now, these are all assertions of Pandora which I've taken. According to them, ads can be incorporated easily into a music service. without diminishing the user experience. And the Pandora's music app has been a success by delivering personalized ads, because they have data in terms of if you are using to listening to an internet radio of a rock and roll channel of 70s or a hard rock channel of 80s or so on and so forth. I mean, it is a very interesting way the American market looks at most of these markets. Even when I met one of the very senior leaders of Netflix, he told me a thing which I didn't know earlier. He said that Netflix valuation is not because of the number of rentals we do. It's because we know who watches what movies. So, you know, that way Pandora knows what music you listen to. Now, this is their assertions, that mobile is quickly becoming the dominant radio outlet for consumers. You know, it's easy to act when device is at hand. So there's far more, you can take an action when you see an ad. And the last point I'll kind of show with a infographic which Pandora has released. Mobile advertising works well from awareness to purchase intent. This is comparison to the early days of online and video. And they are showing mobile works and works faster as per them, as per Pandora. I have seen a similar research in which it says mobile does not work as fast. So there is all kinds of research available. But according to Pandora, mobile is working faster. This is a very interesting graphic in the last point which was made. So Pandora actually claims that they can give you the reach of a print, demographics of a print, interactivity of online, local impact, and purchase intent at the same time. And benefit of a terrestrial radio, a print, and online, all into one on the Pandora radio. And I think it makes a lot of sense. I think actually they have that kind of data. And you know, Pandora is backed by the Genome Project, the Music Genome Project, with the 100 to 600 attributes behind each song. So they have far more capabilities out here. And that is why I think they're a rousing success. Although they're still badly bleeding company due to music rights, but their subscription dollars are rising like crazy. So this is a Pandora case study. These are some ads. The earlier ad was, I think it's a video ad. This is for an app download. So there are different ads. And this is just, I think, a banner. Supporting banner. So this is the ideal scenario, and I think all app developers need to follow this scenario, whatever be the case. This is the first thing that should come in their mind, that my app is going to be very popular among X or Y or Z target audience. Somebody is going to just love it, whether it's free, paid, or whatever. It's like a great success is utility app of Cosmopolitan. It's a $3 app which tells you the sex position of the day. I think it's an app which people might love, or at least that was the intent. So it's an app which does pretty well. Now, here is another assertion which is true. 70-80% of mobile app developers are mobile game developers. Now, here's a case study from EA, Eastern Arts. It's about The Sims, which is the mobile game app. Now, here there are four advertising models, and all four advertising models offer virtual goods for free. So there is that craze for virtual goods, which people get free. And you know how Tencent has a strong internet VAS component to it, more than $1.3 billion coming from just sale of virtual goods or something to that effect. So this is the case study from EA. The four types I'll quickly run through. One are traffic drivers. These are type of in-game advertising. This is a different kind of monetization, wherein traffic is driven to the Facebook page of the advertiser, and virtual good can be claimed from there. The next thing is quests, where you build a deep engagement, and you can get a virtual good by getting into the game and, you know, identifying the good and taking it out. You can have a full tab out there. Or you can have media integrations, wherein if you watch a video or watch an ad, and then you get a virtual gift. I think it's a pretty good model. And at some level, if you are engaged in a very popular game like Sims. It doesn't hurt anyone, and I think EA is doing very well. It's a big case study in US. So these are a couple of examples how both the products are Hindustan Lever products. I think it's Walls and Dove. Another example which has come very, very recently, almost in last 2 weeks, is Amazon, after the launch of the Kindle Fire HD and related products, have opened one-click purchase for Kindle Fire and Kindle Fire HD products. Now, what you can do, the developers can now make games with one-click process. There is a game, Skylanders Cloud Patrol, which will be using it. So you get a physical toy, and you also get the digital copy of that character in the game you're playing. So it's a one-click purchase out, and Amazon is a very strong system. So like I said, the ecosystem also matters a lot. So Amazon as an ecosystem has Amazon Prime, has Kindle, and now has this gaming platform. This is a case study from Japan. It is rewards-based advertising, very similar to EA, but this is a platform-based thing. Time is running out, so I'll just move to their model. The model is very simple. They are charging advertisers cost per install, and on the other side, they have a lot of people signed up with them, close to 10 million. And they ask people to install an app and get rewards. So that's the way they're working, and they have an ecosystem driving this. So developers can work on these kind of models as well. Now, this is a magazines association survey. And it's a very interesting thing that 66% of people who read magazine tablets, they think they'll be spending more time in digital issues. And a lot of people want to buy directly from adverts. So if you, from a tablet, you're seeing a magazine, you see an ad, you can click on the ad and buy the product there and then. The case study is of Zappos Now. Zappos Now is like a Megalog, magazine plus catalog. And in this, you know, you get latest trend, style, and other things. And from the ads, you can directly buy the products. So there is commerce happening from magazines itself. So this is one way of, you know, doing the monetization through magazines. Now, the local advertising is the holy grail, but honestly, in spite of a lot of case studies, if you dig deeper, a lot of people will talk about the difficulty in getting local advertising right in terms of matching coupons to where you are, and the locational data processing is still happening, and there's a lot of hard work happening, and there are terabytes of data which gets analyzed, but still it's not getting at its best. So that's the way I see it. But the day you are able to get this kind of targeting, that what kind of people are there, and there are so many of them right there at this particular point in time, then you can match the consumers and offers. So this is one big monetization point wherein data analysis, and matching of demand and supply is still pending. Once it happens, monetization can be very big. And local merchants getting involved, monetization can be even bigger. Because there is more SME revenue. Like, I mean, at one point in time, Google, it had 80% SME revenues, and still, I think, good 60% in US still comes from SMEs. You know, we need to do profiling, targeting, and ecosystem. I think you learned more from the earlier presentation than I can tell you on this, but it's very important to build the right ecosystem. Consumer profiling, like I said in the earlier slide on location, it is very, very important to look at interest data, behavioral data, and real-time locational data, and build a great real-time bidding. Or, I look at these things far more simply than Prasid and the gentleman from PubMatic. So for me, it's a demand supply equilibrium. It is like, because I come from family of merchants, it is like there are merchants in Chandni Chowk in Delhi, and there are various farmers who will come with their, say, rice or whatever. And you know, they are the central DSPs, quote unquote, to handle that. And then there are takers from retail and wholesale front coming on the other side. So this ecosystem has to be built. There are solid exchanges which you can read about, like NextSage. So if you read about NextSage, there are some solid case studies wherein they are marrying the right kind of advertising with the right kind of inventory available. There are a lot of people who are claiming that they've got the best of it, but I don't think we've reached the right point as yet. That's it. Thank you very much.